Across the great span of human history, countless famines have come and gone, destroying the cultures of once great civilizations, scarring the psyches of entire generations, and rearranging the demographics of the planet time and time again. From Egypt to ancient Rome, to Renaissance Europe, to communist China, famine has, at one time or another, ravaged even the sturdiest of nations. Failed crops, destructive weather patterns, government mismanagement, bad luck, all can lead to famine. Yet no matter the cause of the hunger, or the era during which it struck, or the country that it ravaged, one thing could always be depended upon during times of famine. Fever follows hunger. Hunger and disease have a complex intertwining relationship. As the body weakens from lack of food, and strength slowly ebbs away until one lacks the energy even to wash or change clothing or rise from a soiled bed, fever and pestilence are ushered in like honored guests, everything perfectly prepared for their arrival. All of the places most familiar to a starving Irishman, the unclean bed, the overcrowded hovel, the workhouse, the food depot, the hospital, the mud hut, the filthy streets of a crowded city, even the long wandering road, all were perfect breeding grounds for lice and vermin. And with lice comes fever. Fever was an ever-present killer during the Great Irish Famine, and, much like the blight itself, was completely misunderstood by the common people. The Irish called it famine fever, but in fact many diseases were present. The most common of all was typhus. Conveyed to human hosts by the common louse, typhus is caused by microscopic organisms that ravage the human body, much as the microscopic blight fungus ravaged the potato. Typhus is incredibly contagious. In fact, the American scientist who first identified the typhus bacteria contracted the disease himself in Mexico City and died in 1910 at the age of 39. A louse conveys typhus by first becoming infected himself with the rickettsia bacteria, and the disease actually proves just as fatal to the louse as it does to the human. The bacteria destroys the tiny intestines of the louse before claiming his life. The excrement of an infected louse, when examined under a microscope, is seen to be swarming with organisms. The starving, unwashed masses of Irish peasants and city dwellers, too exhausted to bathe or change their clothes, were crawling with these infected lice. The disease enters the human skin through the bite of the louse. If the infected louse is crushed by a slap from its victim, the bacteria is released from the louse's damaged intestine and enters through the slightest scratch on the skin. The excrement of the contaminated louse is so infectious that its mere deposit on the skin permits infection, even without a bite. Even when the excrement has dried to a fine powder, the bacteria remains active and can enter through the eyes or even be inhaled. Therefore, even those who did not have lice, such as the thousands of benevolent aid workers, doctors, nuns, and clergy, contracted typhus and died anyways. Typhus is a horrendous disease that attacks the blood vessels and impedes circulation. The body swells and turns black, hence the commonly used nickname black fever. What follows are days of catastrophically high fever, delirium, uncontrollable twitching, intense pain, bleeding sores, and eventually death. Another lice-borne illness that devastated Ireland during the famine was relapsing fever. When viewed under a microscope, the microorganism that causes relapsing fever resembles a long thread. Those slender organisms enter the body through the skin, and the infection spreads rapidly from there. Soon after infection, the victim experiences a very high fever and persistent vomiting that lasts for days. If the patient survives that first attack of what was nicknamed the sweating sickness, the fever usually dies down for a while. However, a few days later it returns, sometimes worse than before. These attacks come and go for weeks, relapsing over and over until the already starving patient dies of exhaustion. Relapsing fever also causes jaundice, a yellowing of the skin. An observer in 1847 remarked that a crowd of destitute farmers in Cork were, quote, all gaunt, yellow, hideous. Hence, relapsing fever was also known as yellow fever. 19th century Ireland was the ideal breeding ground for diseases like relapsing fever and typhus. Towns and cities were devoid of sanitation, streets were not cleaned, drainage was unknown. Dublin was affectionately nicknamed Dear Dirty Dublin by many residents. In rural areas, mud cabins made cleanliness impossible. Most dwellings had trickling manure heaps just outside the door. During famine times, many victims were already too weak to even seek help. They huddled together under old rags in their freezing huts, too poor even to buy fuel to heat the water. Whole families were seen lying in roadside ditches gripped by fever. Some locals even nicknamed the disease roadside fever. Fever spread like lightning through the cities, where large groups gathered to beg or search for work. A brush against the skin was enough to transfer infection, and the new victim might infect 100 others over the course of a day. Aid workers showed tremendous courage during this time. Working tirelessly to heal and soothe the sick, starving peasants, all the while putting themselves at risk of infection. In Connemara, 2 out of 3 doctors died. Ireland, a country with a severe shortage of doctors, even in times of plenty, was losing its educated physicians at an alarming rate. As times got tougher, other infamous diseases appeared on the scene to attack the cowering citizens of Ireland. Dysentery, also known as the Bloody Flux, was everywhere throughout the country by 1848. This disease, which had devastated besieged cities of the past, now laid waste to the Irish peasant population. Conveyed to humans via the excrement of flies, dysentery is caused by a group of bacilli that multiply in the stomach and bowels. The digestive tract becomes severely inflamed, leading to ulcers and ultimately gangrene. Scurvy was another plague on the Irish people. Most of the starving Irish were deficient of basic nutrients such as vitamin C, and the side effects of this deprivation can be catastrophic. The gums become spongy, teeth fall out, blood vessels in the legs burst, and the legs turn black up to the thigh. In fact, scurvy was nicknamed Black Leg by the peasants. Before the famine, scurvy was unknown in Ireland due to the enormous quantities of vitamin-rich potatoes the peasants were eating. When the potatoes died, the people lost their sole source of vitamin C. It was understood throughout the civilized world that fever and disease almost always followed famine. Countless historical examples demonstrated the link. Yet, as the Irish potato famine raged on month after month, and the Irish people grew more desperate, the British government made surprisingly few preparations for the inevitable fever epidemic that would soon engulf Ireland. The British Parliament had taken full control of the Irish government back in 1801. Ireland's Parliament had been abolished, Catholics were banned from holding public office, and public services such as disaster relief and care for the desperately poor became England's responsibility. If any government was going to provide aid to the millions of starving Irish, it would have to be England. In March 1846, during the first year of famine, before the fever became a full-blown epidemic, a law was passed by Parliament to, quote, make temporary provision for the relief of destitute poor persons afflicted with fever in Ireland. The law established a Board of Health, ordered more doctors to be sent to Ireland, and funded fever hospitals from the Treasury. This seemed like a step in the right direction, especially to the Irish tenant farmers who lived and worked on land owned by absentee British landlords. From their point of view, so much of Ireland's wealth flowed to England in the form of rent that England had a certain responsibility to pump some of that money back into Ireland in the form of entitlements, infrastructure, and emergency services. The main flaw in the new fever law was that it was allowed to expire just 5 months later, before the fever epidemic was even in full swing. The new Board of Health was soon dissolved, and the extra doctors were fired. When the potato failed completely just 1 month later in September 1846, none of the fever provisions were reestablished. 4 months later, when the nation of Ireland was in the deepest pit of starvation, when grown men were so weak from hunger that they lied down to die in roadside ditches, and thousands upon thousands were dying of fever every week, still no services had been reestablished. Mr. Labouchere, the chief secretary, assured the House of Commons that there was no need to provide additional support. Without government support, the poorly equipped, underfunded county fever hospitals were left to deal with the army of starving, dying fever patients. Across the whole of Ireland, only 28 of these hospitals were functional. In more remote and impoverished areas, such as French Park Roscommon, population 30,000, an area of 135 square miles, there were no hospitals. Even the upper classes were dying. After all, their lack of previous exposure to such epidemics meant that they had no immunity whatsoever. In Ballenrobe, the mortality rate amongst the wealthy was 70%. By early 1847, fever was raging in every corner of Ireland. Still, Chief Secretary Labouchere declared to Parliament that Ireland was free from fever. Some prominent anti-Irish politicians and scholars viewed the famine and fever epidemic in a positive light. Nassau Sr., for example, an economics professor at Oxford University, wrote that the famine, quote, would not kill more than 1 million people, and that would scarcely be enough to do any good. Terrified reports poured into government offices from across Ireland. Hordes of starving, wretched fugitives were pouring into cities, bringing infection with them. In Skibbereen, there was, quote, scarcely a house that had not fever. Police, doctors, teachers, bankers, clergy, and even politicians were sick with it. Typhus was ravaging not just the overcrowded hospitals, but the prisons, army barracks, workhouses, and ports. Mass graves were to be seen across Ireland. So infectious was the fever that some parents, upon learning their child was infected, abandoned the child and fled, leaving him alone in the cabin to die. One government report suggested that the entire city of Cork be quarantined. In the hospitals and government workhouses, ventilation and drainage were largely absent, and the stench was offensive even from a distance. In one hospital, 102 boys shared 24 beds, while 700 slept in the halls, all of them in a fever. In April 1847, a year and a half into the Great Famine, the government finally conceded that a fever epidemic was taking place in Ireland. A new Irish fever relief bill was passed, and funding for hospitals, aid, doctors, and medicine was reestablished. But the law was slow to take effect, constantly hindered by Ireland's almost total lack of infrastructure and stubbornly inefficient bureaucracy. In one county, when the guardians were ordered to erect a new fever hospital, they refused to spend the money. Despite the new law, people in fever were reported to be lying in the streets without accommodation. Instead of building hospitals, officials in many districts opted to purchase army tents to house the sick. In other areas, though aid was available, the suffering population could not get access to it. Many thousands upon thousands were unable to seek help at hospitals, for example, because they were too weak to venture out in the cold. Therefore, it's difficult to estimate how many people died of fever in Ireland. One doctor estimated that for each sick peasant who applied for medical aid, there were often four or five back in the cabin who could not. In addition, many poor hated and feared the fever hospitals. The Irish hospital had a terrible reputation as a stinking death house and hopeless pit of despair, where men were crammed into overcrowded rooms, where human waste and refuse littered the floors, where overworked doctors could offer no relief from the pain and became infected just like the patients, where all who entered died in agony. In Ennis, for example, it was reported that people survived longer outside in the fields than in the hospital. Many Irishmen simply preferred to die in their own homes or out in the countryside rather than on the floor of a cramped hospital room. Over time, however, the new fever law could have been called a moderate success. Piles of filth were removed from Skibbereen, cabins were cleansed and corpses buried. 23,000 patients were given new accommodations, and a wave of doctors and nurses were hired. The epidemic continued to rage across Ireland, but at least the slow turning wheels of government were in motion, and certain areas experienced varying degrees of relief. There's no accurate prediction of how many Irishmen died of fever. There were no official records kept, no legal register of deaths, and those who tried to count the casualties were thwarted by a variety of factors. In the countryside, for example, many peasants displayed a tendency to shrink from British government officials, even those who came to offer help to the sick or to count the dead. Statisticians would arrive to keep records of the epidemic, only to find every door in the village locked, windows shuttered. Thousands of Irish disappeared during this time, victims of a Holocaust. Whether they died of fever, or starved, or froze, or emigrated, or simply wandered off into the forest, is unknown to this day. No one will ever know exactly how many people died, but one estimation is that 10 times more people died of disease than famine.